it's very surprising when you can arrive in a country like China to the most modern airports to get on freeways that use tolling mechanisms. The roads are in great shape.
Infrastructure is a living system. It needs maintenance, it needs energy to keep it going. If we don't provide any inputs into the system, it'll slowly deteriorate, it'll slowly degrade, it'll be recaptured by nature.
The idea is that the vehicle should be moving to transport something. So if it's just sitting in traffic, it's not being productive.
So not only is our product being delivered to customers on this highway, we also have about 2,000 employees who work in Owatonna.
No new tax mentality. The analogy could be no new roof.
And I think all of this comes down to expecting more of our political leaders than simply short-term sloganeering or the blame game.
Hello, my name is Vivian Williams, a Minnesotan like you, and I want to share some important facts with you today about transportation, and I want you to start thinking about positioning Minnesota for a vibrant future in a very competitive world. Today, just as in the past, our prosperity and quality of life are shaped by our transportation system. For example, in the 1950s, elected officials had to deal with a housing shortage, a post-war economic slump, a population explosion, and an astonishing increase in the number of cars and trucks on our roads, as you can see.
By 1956, there were more than 65 million cars on our roads, with 90 million forecast by 1975. Clearly, it was a time for national action.
In 1955, President Eisenhower, a Republican president, had the incredible vision and foresight to create America's interstate highway system. It was a massive investment that pulled the economy out of a slump and transformed American commerce in ways that are still paying dividends almost 60 years later. The Greatest Generation paid for that new system with a 4 cent per gallon user fee at a time when gas was selling for 23 cents a gallon.
It was done in a sense of shared sacrifice. It wasn't a something for nothing proposition. We knew that we had to pay the price for long-term gains, and we did it without a bunch of partisan rancor. We celebrate that today, but we don't really emulate that today.
There were differences of opinion back in those days, just as there are today. But unlike today, they usually found a way to get the job done. Their successes have had a powerful impact on American life to this day. A quarter century later, another Republican president, Ronald Reagan, worked with a Democratic Congress to fashion the Surface Transportation Act of 1982.
The state of our transportation system affects our commerce, our economy, and our future. That's why I'm pleased today to sign House Resolution 6211.
The bill that President Reagan signed raised the federal fuel tax by 5 cents a gallon and addressed many of the pressing needs of our nation for many years to come. But three decades have passed since then, and with dramatic cost increases in materials and construction costs, we keep falling behind. That's the reason we are still trying to get by with a lot of Eisenhower-era infrastructure, and that's why we've added only 3% in new road capacity since 1980. Unfortunately, we now have more than twice as many cars on our highways as we did back then. The resulting congestion on our roadways is an impediment to higher productivity and a drain on our economy. Minnesota's economy depends on a strong, comprehensive, interconnected transportation system that moves people and products around the state efficiently. And after all these years of slow or no progress in both St. Paul and Washington, thoughtful Minnesotans are asking the same question President Kennedy posed in 1962.
What's the use of the success of a political party unless that party is being used by the nation for a great national purpose?
When you're in public life, you really need to be looking at the long term. We need political leaders who will sit down and look at facts. Facts are facts.
Facts are facts. The transportation needs in our state have been well documented with endless studies.
We have the long-range plans for what our transportation system needs. We just don't have the funding to make those plans a reality.
And speaking of facts, fact is, the price of oil, steel, aggregates, cement, and other materials that go into building infrastructure have gone up significantly. In just 1 5-year period, between 2003 and 2008, the producer price index for construction materials rose a cumulative 30.2%, twice as fast as the consumer price index.
We can't have a system where the costs keep going up and the revenue is static.
Fact is, crude oil has gone from $30 a barrel in 2003 to $80 to $90 or more per barrel today. We make asphalt with oil byproducts.
The asphalt cement that we use in our asphalt mixtures for paving roads has gone up from 10 years ago, it was $150 per ton, and this year we're paying about $500.
Fact is, Minnesota's population will increase by almost 1 million people over the next three decades, and those new residents will generate tens of thousands of new trips every day. Fact is that many of our bridges are wearing out and need replacement. Believe it or not, we still have about 2,000 timber bridges in Minnesota. These wooden structures aren't holding up very well in our climate. So you see, we have projects all over the state waiting for funding, projects that address critical needs, including the long backlog for road repairs and rebuilds, bridge repair and replacement, and the expansion of transit.
Well, imagine there was no transportation. There'd be no economic activity.
Particularly in western and southwestern Minnesota, agriculture is really critically important. And as a result, maintaining serviceable year-round roads is critically important.
A driver driving a truck can't carry as much of a load as he would like to be able to because we have weight restrictions on roads that are driven by the infrastructure that we've put in place.
Time is money. And when you're working in the construction industry, we have just-in-time deliveries.
The world is making major investments in many of the countries that I travel to, where it becomes very noticeable to see the differences in the infrastructure, in the quality, and in the standards that allow any economy to be competitive.
Whether it's rail, whether it's roads, whether it's bridges, whether it's airline hubs, I think transportation is a responsibility of government. That's not going to happen in the private sector.
We have a moral responsibility to maintain the valuable assets we inherited. Here in Minnesota, we face a funding shortfall of at least $30 billion over the next 20 years for our state highways, local roadways, and bridges, as well as for transit in both urban and regional centers, passenger rail, ports, and waterways.
And let's not forget about the many rural transit systems all across the state that allow people to get to work, to remain in their own homes.
Each year we fail to act, it costs us about 10% more to complete a given project. Let's not kid ourselves. That neglect hits your pocketbook hard because it will substantially increase the cost of operating your car. So let's say you pay $750 to replace rims or struts or make some other significant repair. Let's also say you're an average driver who puts about 15,000 miles on your car annually. If you do the math, that repair will add about 5 cents per mile to your cost of operation. That's 5 cents a mile, not 5 cents a gallon. By comparison, a 5 cent increase in the fuel tax would result in a great amount of local road maintenance, but would cost you only $50 a year.
And as a society, we should be willing to pay that to get better roads. Our parents did, and they made the infrastructure. We're just wearing it out.
What about the cost of congestion?
In 2010, Twin Cities commuters spent 45 hours, more than a full work week, stuck in traffic congestion.
When you couple that with wasted fuel, congested highways in the metro area are costing individual commuters an estimated $800 per year, to say nothing of the environmental impact of stalled cars on the air we breathe.
Waiting to get onto Highway 5, you can see stacking sometimes 12 to 15 cars waiting at an uncontrolled intersection. That seems pretty wasteful, just in terms of the amount of gasoline that's being used without actually making any headway.
The output of pollution of idled cars and stop and go traffic is much worse than if everyone was moving along.
And it's going to get worse. Population growth will compound the problem. Take a single year, 2011. The population of the 7-county metro area grew by almost 24,000 that year. Here in the Twin Cities, we are already competing with those folks for parking and for space on our congested roadways. But the metro area is not the only concern.
We will continue to see growth in areas like St. Cloud and Rochester and Moorhead. The Brainerd area continues to grow.
Safety is an issue as well, and there's a lot more to the story than the collapse of the I-35W bridge.
We have a lot of people that are running up and down these highways at very high speeds, and it's important that we all have confidence that these are good roads and safe roads.
We have over 9,000 ambulance runs that end up at Ridgeview Medical Center. Having that number of emergency vehicles requires a highway that has extended turn lanes. It has the ability for emergency vehicles to get around traffic, and currently that doesn't exist.
Many two-lane highways in our rural areas are dangerous, and in a home where a tragic car accident has left a gap in the family circle, the cost of our neglect takes on a very heavy toll. Now that we've considered the facts, it's time to consider the future. We have a number of exciting road projects on the drawing board that'll help create a vibrant future for Minnesota. We need to finish building in some corridors, especially where the highway switches from 2 to 4 lanes and then back to 2 lanes.
People in the Twin Cities area are very familiar with the bottlenecks that we all encounter every day on highways like 35, 94, 169.
We need to finish work on Highway 610, Highway 14, Highway 23, and Highway 212.
And of course, all across Minnesota, people are very familiar with highways that need to be repaired.
Some of the most futuristic projects are transit improvements that will enable us to better compete with cities like Phoenix, Houston, Denver, and Portland, cities where major transit money has already been invested. In the western suburbs, there is great excitement about the Southwest Corridor. On the near north side of Minneapolis, there's the Bottineau Transit Way. In downtown Minneapolis, near the new Twins ballpark, designers are looking at ways to join several lines in what's called the interchange. In the East Metro area, businesses and residents are anxious to see movement on the Gateway Corridor. Equally exciting is the work that's going on at the Union Depot in St. Paul as the Central Corridor is being built out. The option of someday linking the Twin Cities to both coasts through Chicago by means of high-speed rail cannot be dismissed. This is only a partial list of the opportunities.
And to create a world-class transportation system is only going to help some of that entrepreneurial and American spirit.
Progress will only come if we act together with a common vision and with a measure of sacrifice. We know from experience that an investment in transportation will provide a high rate of return in terms of growing our economy and creating new jobs. What happened to our capacity for bold action? There is little we Americans cannot do if only we can imagine ourselves doing it. Let's start doing it so that all the really important things that are happening in the future will be happening here. The leadership for all this has to come from state government, and any new revenue must be dedicated to its stated purpose and not be used to fill gaps elsewhere. The legislature can work out the details on revenue sources, but they must account for the fact that the world is changing. We are driving more fuel-efficient cars, which burn less gas, and that increasingly we will be using non-petroleum-based fuels. A gas tax, which is a user fee, in order to be fair, must affect all users equally. A transportation system can be an impediment, a safety hazard, and a daily frustration, or it can bring the jobs, economic security, and mobility we need to live our lives independently. The choice is ours to make. Seek out your elected officials and tell them that you want fewer sound bites and more action. Less blame game and more cooperation. And remember, if we don't start working together for a better future, we will not have one. Thank you.